Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Welcome to another edition of Sunday Night Live with Pasadena Church. Friends, we are so glad to have you join us this day as we are preparing to go into a time of worship, worshiping the Lord and hearing a transforming word that I believe is going to bless your heart today. But before we go there, I want you to hear my heart concerning the reopening of our church, Pasadena Church. Now, I recognize that there are other churches and pastors that are anxious to get back into their buildings and gather together again, and that our government has given the green light to do so. However, we, Pasadena Church, we are not there yet and have decided to wait until we are better equipped and prepared to ensure the safety and well-being of our members and of our community. The church must be an example and light to the community. So we have a mandate, I believe a divine mandate, to do things properly. So then, my friends, we will continue our online services until further notice and continue to practice those safety and social measures that will lead us all out of this pandemic. Now, I'd like you to hear from a trusted medical professional who happens to be an active member of Pasadena Church, Dr. Shakir Email, with a special word for us today.
Hello, church family. I bring you greetings from the front lines. I want to begin by thanking all of you for the prayers, support, and masks you have sent our way. Your generosity and loving kindness have made us stronger in these difficult days. COVID-19 has upended our way of life, and most, if not all of us, have been privy to the tragedy that it leaves in its wake. That said, the good news is that because of our staying at home, homeschooling, judicious use of masks, and good hand hygiene, California has successfully flattened the curve, thereby saving countless lives. This is the power of social distancing. While we have cause to celebrate, the call to action has not ended. If we reopen too soon or too fast, more people will fall ill and more, unfortunately, will die. That is why it is so important to get this right. So, even as the weather ripens and the sun smiles down upon us, I encourage each of you to practice restraint. I often dream of the day that I can see you all face to face, catch up on old times, and feel your embrace. That day is not today, but we can get there together.
You gotta worship with us, come on, yeah! Come on, everybody, like this. He is the Lord of the harvest. Amen. And he wants to use us as workers in his harvest field. If you love the Lord this morning, say yeah.
Amen. yeah. And we worship you. Come on, everybody, everybody. Tell the Lord you're Lord.
Lord, Lord of the heart.
And we worship.
And we worship.
We worship.
You.
We worship you.
Lord, Lord of the
yeah,
heart.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. This is my favorite
you.
Part.
Worship.
Tell the Lord, say you are.
You are my daily,
daily,
daily bread.
Bread. Say you are. You are my peace. You are my shield. Hallelujah. You are everything that I need. Amen. You are a way out of a way. Amen. When there is no way, you make a way for me. Somebody shout hallelujah. If you really believe it, I want you to clap your hands one more time. You are my daily bread. Tell the Lord you are.
You are my.
You are. on and give God a praise in this place.
Hallelujah.
You provide the fire. I'll provide the sacrifice. If you provide the spirit, I will open up inside. provide the sacrifice. Just pour out your spirit, and I will open up inside. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up.
Glory, hallelujah. Wow, what a powerful time of worshiping Him. Just asking the Lord to fill us up. I don't know about you, but maybe you've just been feeling a little empty, or that you've been running on empty. And so this has just been a wonderful, refreshing time in the Lord's presence to invite Him to fill you up, to just restore that joy, restore your hope, restore your peace. He's able to do that. The wonderful thing about God is that He never leaves us empty. Thank you, Lord. And I just want to share a passage. It's found in John. And in this passage, in John chapter 6, Jesus is speaking in a synagogue, and He's sharing with disciples about how they must eat of His flesh and drink of His blood. And it's a pretty hard saying for many of them, and they just decide, you know, this guy, he's asking too much, and they decide to walk away. And Jesus looks at His 12 disciples and He asks them, do you want to leave too? And then Peter, he speaks up and he says, Lord, where would we go? Thou hast the words of life. And I'm just hearing the Spirit of God saying, you know, to you even now, do you want to leave? Do you want to walk away? In the midst of this pandemic, I know you're tired. I know that you're weary and you're being this living sacrifice day by day. Do you want to leave? And by the power of the Spirit of God, we're declaring, no, you are our portion, Lord. You are our God. We have this revelation of Jesus Christ. Where would we go? To you we run, to you we live, in you we live and move and have our being. So where we feel tired, where we feel empty, oh God, fill us up again. Renew our strength, refresh us in your presence this day. So let's just go to Him in prayer. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we just love you so much. And we're so thankful for your presence in our lives. We declare you have the words of life, God. And we're just praying, Lord, for a divine exchange, God. Where we are feeling down, we just ask for your joy that would overflow in us today. God, we're asking for you to fill us with your peace that subdues anxious thoughts. Oh God, and fill us even more with you, who you are, and the substance of who you are, God, with faith that prevails over fear, oh Lord. That, God, that you would fill us with your goodness, fill us with your kindness, that we may continue to do those good works, to show kindness in action to others these days. Hallelujah. Oh God, and may you just overwhelm us with your love, that we would overflow, that we would overflow. Oh God, that we would overflow with your Spirit, with your love, with your glory. Hallelujah. Oh God, with your joy. Oh Father, we're just asking that you would go deep within us, oh Lord, where we have been empty, that you would fill us Refresh us again. Hallelujah. We just lay down all of these cares. We lay down every anxious thought, oh God, and we just look to you to be our strength. You are our strength. Strength like no other. Hallelujah. So, Father, just come now. Release your healing power and presence over sick and weary bodies, emotional tiredness, God. Come and renew our strength. We receive it today, Lord. We receive the filling, the infilling of your spirit and your power in the mighty name of Jesus. Come on, people of God, say amen. I'm no longer empty. I'm filled with the presence and the power of God. Thank you, Lord.
All right. Ooh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Here we go, y'all. Send a little message out to those of y'all who feel like you're struggling. He said, how can you smile when your world is crumbling down? I said, here's my secret. When I wanna cry, I take a look around and I see that I'm getting by. And I hold on.
Hold on.
Change is coming.
Change is coming.
Hold on. To run away from the pain inside. Now it's your business. Do whatever you want to do. But if it don't work out, here's what you ought to do. Yeah, just hold on.
All around, friends letting you down. We know how that is. Well, here's a little simple song that we like to sing, and it goes a little like this. Come on, choir, sing it.
Say la la
la la
la la.
You
go.
Praise the Lord. Amen. I hope that you're encouraged today. Thank you, Brother Earl. Thank you for this wonderful worship team and amazing band. Just say it out loud. Hold on. Change is coming. Hallelujah. That's a powerful, powerful song. One that we love and we love to dance to at Pasadena Church. Well, I'd like for us to get into the word today, and I want us to talk about waiting. Talk about waiting. I've got a word today, and the title of my message today is called I'm Working on Waiting. Can you say that with me? Come on. I'm working on waiting. Let me hear you say it. All right, all right, all right. Now, as you may remember, the last time we were together, I spoke about the Lord being our great trainer and our great teacher, being the greatest trainer and teacher of all times, and how one of the greatest lessons we learn from him is the lesson of perseverance, the lesson of patience. If you remember the message, that's not as easy as it sounds, because remember, it takes tribulation or trouble to create or manufacture patience in us. And today, beloved, I want to build on that truth, because a key component of perseverance, a key component of getting tough and being patient, is learning how to wait. Learning how to wait. I know waiting has become a lost art. It's become a lost discipline, considering the fact that many of our national leaders and even some spiritual leaders are bypassing common sense and discernment to get back to normal. This is unfortunate, because I believe there is a greater lesson for us to learn, as well as an opportunity for us all to grow and make others better by working on waiting. Tell somebody, I'm working on waiting. Hallelujah. You see, ultimately, we must remain prayerful. We've got to remain prayerful and look to the Lord for His wisdom and direction. I can't speak for all the churches or all of the pastors. Just know that, as I said before, Pasadena Church has never stopped serving. We've never closed. We've never stopped continuing to fellowship and stay connected to each other and to our community. We simply haven't done it inside of a building. And furthermore, beloved, just know it doesn't take a building to be the church. I know if we were in service, somebody would say it again, Pastor. I'm going to say it again. It doesn't take a building to be the church. Say, I know that this is what I'm hearing the Lord say to my heart and to our church. Can you just say it one more time? I'm working on waiting. Well, as you know, waiting can feel like a job. It can feel like hard work when you're in the middle of it. The truth is, we live in a society and a day and age when nobody wants to wait anymore. For example, if you've ever had to wait for a bus or a train, it seems like that bus is taking forever. It seems like that train will never come. And we're sitting there, we're looking at our watches, we're looking down the road to see if we can get a glimpse of it. But that can be painful, waiting on a bus. Or maybe if you're like me, when pumping gas and you get to that time when you're pumping the gas and the numbers go automatic, it goes into automatic mode to slow down. Man, it seems like it takes forever for those final drops of gasoline to get into that car. And Lord knows the grocery store. Amen. We're the way things are right now, sometimes we have to wait outside for the store to clear up just to get inside. But then when we get to that line, oh my goodness, that line. And then that clerk, and see, I don't know about you, but just the other day, it seems like that clerk was scanning every one of those items in front of me so slow. Do you have to scan every item that slow? I was thinking in my head, but I didn't say it out loud. I know those might be some funny examples, but I had a real life experience just a few days ago where I didn't want to wait. As a matter of fact, I insisted on not waiting. I chipped my tooth, and when I chipped my tooth, I bit into some food and my back tooth chipped, And I called my dentist and I said, well, I chipped my tooth and I'd like to come in to get it repaired. And the woman said, well, can you wait until next Thursday? And I took a sip of my tea, my cold iced tea that I had in front of me. And when I sipped that tea, the nerves in that tooth hit that cold. And I said to the woman, I said, I can't wait. I'll come in. You give me the time as soon as you can get me. And she said, well, can you come in today? And I said, hallelujah, thank you, Lord. And we were able to get everything squared away. Well, I want to talk to you today about this matter of waiting, the spiritual matter of the patience and perseverance that we develop by waiting on God. And beloved, there are plenty of examples in the scriptures of people who waited on God and people who didn't wait on him. And the main difference between the two can be drastic when we wait on him, when we don't wait on him. There's a couple of examples I want to show you before I get into the main portion of what I want to share. Saul, for example, as a matter of fact, at the beginning of his kingdom, at his inauguration, when Samuel was anointing Saul, he gives him some specific instructions from God. And Saul refused to wait, and it cost him the kingdom before the ink was even dry on his contract. My Lord, it's found in 1 Samuel chapter 10, verse 8. I pray that you brought your Bibles with you today because we're going to surf and get in the Word a little bit. So make sure you have your Bibles close to you so that you can look these scriptures up as I share them with you today. 1 Samuel 10, 8. Says it like this. Samuel said, then after you've done this, he said, you should go to Gilgal. I'll come a little later. So wait for me. Samuel told Saul to wait. Wait for me. It may even take a week for me to get there, 7 days. But when I come, I'll offer sacrifices and offerings to the Lord. I'll tell you what to do next. Wait for me. When I get there, I will offer sacrifices to the Lord and I'll give you your next instructions. But as we know, you read the story, please, in your devotion time this week, go back and read the story of Saul and Samuel and of David. That will be wonderful. If you move on to 1 Samuel chapter 13, verse 11, we can see what happens with Saul. The Bible says Samuel comes after Saul took things into his own hands because he didn't wait. Samuel says in verse 11, what have you done? Samuel asked. Saul answered, my soldiers, they were leaving in all directions. You know, they were starting to leave and you didn't come when you were supposed to. The Philistines were gathering at Michmash and I was worried that they would attack me here at Gilgal. I hadn't offered a sacrifice to ask for the Lord's help. So listen to what Saul says. So I forced myself to offer a sacrifice on the altar fire. That was stupid, Samuel said. You didn't obey the Lord your God. If you had obeyed him, if you had waited, someone from your family would always have been king of Israel. But no, you disobeyed, and so the Lord won't choose anyone else from your family to be king. In fact, he has already chosen the one he wants to be the next leader of his people, just because Saul didn't wait. But then on the other hand, we find and we know the story of Job and the patience of Job, all that Job went through. I mean, it reads better than any type of drama that you could ever watch on television, all the things that Job endured. But Job had decided, Job purposed in his heart that he was going to wait on God. As a matter of fact, Job waited on the Lord and he was restored. He understood that putting his hope in God meant ultimate vindication, which means the resurrection. So Job says in chapter 14, verse 14, if a man die, shall he live again? Job said, all the days of my appointed time will I wait till my change comes. Oh, there's something powerful about waiting. Waiting until your change comes. Waiting until God gives you the direction and the instruction that you need, that we need to live and to do it in a victorious manner. Amen. Beloved, I'm not sure about the direction that our government will give. We're not sure about what comes down from our governor in California tomorrow morning. But what I do know is that I'm determined to wait on God. Even if it feels like work, I'm working on waiting. Come on, say it one more time. I'm working on waiting. Hallelujah. So when we're working on waiting, I want to give you an acrostic of the word wait. I want to give you each letter, what that means, to help you remember what it takes for us to wait. The first thing for us to wait, number one, the W, we must be willing to obey God. We must be willing. The W stands for what? Willing. We must be willing to obey God. You remember Abraham, the father of all who was faithful. The scripture says Abraham's faith was proved by his willingness to offer his only son to God. This willingness opened up the blessing of God to Abraham and to us because we are his offspring. He is the father of all who believe, according to Romans chapter 4, verse 16. So. The Lord promises, you know the story. We've talked about Brother Abe in previous services. The Lord says to Abraham in his old age, I'm going to bless you and your wife Sarah with children. And your children, your offspring, would outnumber the grains of sand, the stars in the sky. I'm going to bless you and allow you to become a father of many nations. And the Bible says that Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. And as the story goes, you know, eventually Abraham and Sarah, 9,900 years old, has a child. So this is the fulfillment of God's promise of his blessing. But then the Lord says, Abraham, I want you to sacrifice your son. The son that I blessed you with, the blessing that I gave you. Now the Lord says, I want you to give him to me. And the Bible says that Abraham did not doubt. He did not waver, but he obeyed the Lord. He was willing to offer his only son. The story picks up in Genesis chapter 22, verse 12, when Abram has taken his son up the mountain and he's getting ready to slay his son, to sacrifice his son before the Lord. And in verse 12, the Lord calls out and says, Abraham, Abraham, don't hurt the boy or harm him in any way. The angel said, now I know. Now the Lord says, angel of the Lord says, I know that you truly obey God because you were willing to offer your only son. You scroll down to verse 16 of Genesis 22. The Lord says, you were willing to offer the Lord your only son. And so he makes you this solemn promise. So, beloved, salvation comes to those who are willing to follow the Lord. As a matter of fact, the requirements of discipleship, the true requirement of discipleship, Jesus says, is that we must be willing to deny ourselves, to take up our cross and to follow him. These times that we're living in, especially in light of this pandemic, is calling us to have a willingness to deny ourselves. I know you want to go out. I know we want to go back into our church building. I know we want to go out and hang out with our friends and all of these things, but it's not time. So we must be willing to deny ourselves, take up our cross. It's a heavy cross to bear because I'm a people person. Anybody who knows Kerwin Limon Manning, you know that I'm a people person. And we're living in a time where I can't hug the people that I love and I care for. I can't be there with them at crucial times in their lives and the things that's going on in their families. It's hurting me to the core. But I'm willing to trust and obey the Lord, willing to obey God. And you must be willing as well. And now for the A. The A stands for paying attention to his commands, paying attention to his commands, to attend to the Lord's words, to listen. One translation says we must listening, to lean in to what the Lord says and what he's saying to us. And so as I was thinking about this, of course, by now, you know, I'm always going back to my childhood. Most of our stuff that we're working through, I believe, comes from family of origin issues. But again, with Kerwin Manning, many of the times that I got disciplined as a child and as a teenager was because I didn't do what my parents told me to do. Can I get a witness? I didn't do it because the truth is I wasn't listening closely enough to their instructions. My mother would say, okay, I've got to go, but put a load of clothes in the washer for me. Make sure you separate the whites from the colors. Don't wash them together. Yes, ma'am. And make sure before you do anything else, fix your bed, straighten your bed up, and clean your room. Yes, ma'am. Many times, as you know, if you're like me, at the time when I needed or wanted to do something later on, go somewhere with friends, that the consequences of my lack of attention to their commands would come back and ruin my weekend. Why do these white clothes have red all over? Oh, well, hey, Ma, can I go to the skating rink with Lamar and with Jennifer and the rest of them? Well, did you clean your room? Ah. Consequences. What does it mean to attend to God's commands? I'm glad you asked. It means that we must pay attention to what he says. We must pay attention to what the Bible says. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20. I love this passage. This is what Derek Prince calls, and I call, God's medicine bottle promise. But in Proverbs chapter 4, verses 20 through 22, listen to what the word of the Lord says. The writer says, my child, listen carefully to everything I say. Don't forget a single word, but think about it all. Intentionally. Knowing these teachings will mean true life and good health for you. My Lord, my Lord. Don't you know that there is a difference between hearing and listening? We all have said to someone who, in the hood where I was raised, we would say they're talking out the side of their neck. They're just talking and going at, we would say to them, sometimes they'd be going, we'd say, I hear you. That usually meant that I hear the sounds coming out of your mouth, but I'm not going to respond. I'm not going to do what you're asking me to do. But when we decide to listen, we're making an intentional effort to internalize and to remember what they are saying and to follow through. When we're paying attention, that helps us also to follow through. You see, hearing is a mechanical function of our ears. Hearing is a part of our five senses. But listening, beloved, is paying attention, being attentive. In this passage in Proverbs, that's what this word means. Pay attention, be attentive, carefully take in everything the speaker is saying because it is a matter of life or death. That's the A. And now for the I. W is what? W is we must be willing to obey the Lord. A, we must pay attention to him. And I takes it off of ourselves and to others. We must start interceding for others. Help me, Holy Ghost. We must start interceding for others. They say that the best way to get out of our own funk or our own drought is to help somebody else. And I want you to know, I believe with all of my heart, that intercession is standing in the gap for someone else. Intercession is standing in the gap on someone else's behalf. It is praying. It is pleading with God for somebody else to be delivered, to be healed, to be set free, not for ourselves. When you pray, it's okay to pray for yourself. As a matter of fact, many times I've quoted and prayed the prayer of Jabez over my life. Oh, Lord, if you would bless me indeed, that you would enlarge my territories, you expand my borders, that you would keep evil far from me. That's a good prayer to pray over yourself. I mean, it's okay to pray over yourself, but when we intercede, it is for others. And as believers, our focus and our hearts must be directed towards the well-being and the welfare of others. Oh, Lord, I see a trail that's calling me to chase it. I'm not going to chase that trail because everybody's concerned about themselves and their churches. But I'm not going to go there. Let's just get back to this. We must start interceding for others. Jesus went away so that he could pray for us constantly. Jesus withdrew often to solitary places while he was on the earth. But when Jesus went back to heaven, the Bible tells us that he went back so that he could take his rightful place next to God and intercede for us. Ah, my Lord. You remember the last time we were together, we discovered that Satan is our real enemy. One of our points from the last message was know your enemy. Satan is our real enemy, and he is known in the scriptures as the accuser of the brethren. And when you hear the word, when I hear the word accuser, I think about a courtroom drama, somebody being accused of a crime or being accused of something. Satan accuses us constantly in the courtroom of life. But praise God, we have a spiritual dream team on our side, according to Romans chapter 8, verses 26 through 34. It's a lengthy text, but I got to read this for you. I pray that this is blessing you. It's blessing me. If this is blessing you, come on, just text it in somewhere online. This is blessing my heart. Romans 8, 26 through 34 in the contemporary English version reads like this. In certain ways, we are weak, but the Spirit is here to help us. For example, when we don't know what to pray for, the Spirit, watch this, prays for us in ways that cannot be put into words. All of our thoughts are known to God. He can understand what is in the mind of the Spirit as the Spirit prays for God's people. We know that God is always at work for the good of everyone who loves Him. They are the ones God has chosen for his purpose. And he has always known who his chosen ones would be. He has decided to let them become like his own son so that his son would be the first of many children. God then accepted the people he had already decided to choose, and he has shared his glory with them. What can we say about all of this? Paul writes, if God is on our side, we read this one last week. If God is on our side, can anyone be against us? God did not keep back his own son, but he gave him for us. If God did this, won't he freely give us everything else? If God says his chosen ones are acceptable to him, can anyone bring charges against him? Or here it is, or can anyone condemn them? No, indeed. Christ died and was raised to life. And here it is. And now he is at God's right side speaking to him for us. I like the old translation that says ever making intercession for us. The Holy Spirit is interceding for us as he speaks God's language in verse 26. The Lord himself is interceding for us in 27 and 28. He's caring about the things that happened to us and working it all out for our good. But then in verse 34, Jesus is next to God interceding for us without stopping. He doesn't take a recess when it comes to you and I. He doesn't take a break. He is ever living to make intercession for you and I. And if this is true for us, then the word calls us in the same way. We're called to love our neighbors. We're called to love and pray for our enemies. Let me say this. I'm praying. You might have heard some things coming off a little harsh today because I'm just passionate about what's happening around us. But I am praying for our leaders. I'm praying for our president. I'm praying for our Congress. I'm praying for our Supreme Court justices. I'm praying for them. I'm praying for our pastors and our community leaders, praying for our government leaders, even those I don't agree with. And friend, I want you to know, I'm praying for you today. I'm praying for you. The Bible says that God wouldn't forgive Job's friends until they went back and let him pray for them. What if there's some people in your life who have even hurt you or abandoned you or did you wrong, and God is saying to you today, pray for them so that I can forgive them. Will you pray for them? I know what you're saying in your heart. You may even be saying it out loud where you're watching this. Now you're meddling, Pastor. I know. W, be willing. A is pay attention. The I is intercede for others. And now the T. The T stands for learning to trust God's promise. in all of our waiting and in the development of our patience, how we're dealing with this pandemic and everything else that goes on in our lives, always bring us back to, are we trusting what God says about us? Are we trusting God's promise? We must learn to trust His promise. I remember the old song the saints would sing, Learning to Lean. There were some songs that just resonated and just got in me, and I still can hear them singing to this day. Learning to lean, I'm learning to lean. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. Finding more power than I'd ever dreamed. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. Hallelujah. We must learn to lean on Him. We must learn to trust God's promise. As a matter of fact, we're talking about waiting. And in these scriptures, many of them that I've already shared with you, the word wait literally means to trust Him. The word wait means to place our hope in Him. And when we trust God, we can then know His promises are sure, according to Psalm 19, according to Psalm 119. When we trust God, we know that He is faithful to His promise. As a matter of fact, when we trust God, we can be sure that we won't burn up, we won't burn out, we won't be overwhelmed, we won't be overtaken. We're told this in Isaiah chapter 43, one of the promises that the Lord gives us. In the Message translation, Isaiah 43. But now God's message, the God who made you in the first place, Jacob, the one who got you started, Israel. This is what the Lord says. Don't be afraid. I've redeemed you. I've called your name. You're mine. When you are in over your head, I'll be there with you. When you're in rough waters, you will not go down. Come on, somebody say it. I'm not going down. You will not go down. When you're between a rock and a hard place, it won't be a dead end because I am God, your personal God. Hallelujah. The Holy of Israel, your Savior. I paid a huge price for you. All of Egypt with rich cushion Seba thrown in. That's how much the Lord says you mean to me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. That I mean, that's how much I love you, he says. I'd sell off the whole world to get you back. Trade creation just for you. Hallelujah. That's how much God loves us. And that's how, because of that, we can say, Lord, I trust you. I'm putting my hope in you because of your never failing love for me. And I want you to know, this is a word of encouragement to someone that's watching today. You're not going to lose your mind. I know what Brother DMX said, and it was popular. Y'all gonna make me lose my mind. You're not gonna lose your mind up in here. You've got to declare, according to Corinthians 2:16, I have the mind of Christ. But also, we're not gonna lose our mind because of God's promise in Isaiah chapter 23, verse 6. Amen. I hope this is blessing you. I hope these scriptures are going to encourage you and build you up this week. In Isaiah 26:3, it says, you will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you, all whose thoughts are fixed on you. Because we trust in the Lord, and when we trust in Him, not only do we have the peace of God, but we also find strength in Him. And you all were probably waiting for this one from the beginning of this message. You're talking about waiting. Surely you've got to read Isaiah 40:31, Pastor. Well, I'm going to read it now. Isaiah 40:31 says, but those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. They will soar high on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. Amen. He gives us peace when we trust in Him. We find new strength when we trust in Him. And also we will not be put to shame when we trust in Him. According to Isaiah 49:23, it says, kings and queens will serve you and care for all your needs. They will bow to the earth before you and lick the dust from your feet. Then you will know that I am the Lord. Those who trust in me will never be put to shame. Hallelujah. I'm working on waiting. I don't know about you today, but I want you to make up in your heart and in your mind. Let this be your resolve. I'm going to wait on God. I'm working. Even if it feels like work, whatever I've got to do, I'm going to wait on God. How are we going to wait? Number one, we're going to be willing. We're going to be willing. Hallelujah. Come on, say willing, 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 willing. We're going to be willing to obey God. And then the A, what do we have to do? We've got to pay attention to his commands. We got to lean into God. When he's speaking, we've got to lean in and make sure that we're listening to everything he says. Then he calls us to intercede for others. Not only us, but there are others out there that need us to pray for them and to pray with them. And finally, we, beloved, we must trust, learn to trust God's promise. I'd like to pray for you today. I'd like to pray. And before we pray, I want to ask you, have you given your life to Christ? Have you made Jesus first place on the throne of your heart? If you haven't, it's really going to be impossible for you to really wait on him and to trust him in the way that I've been describing it today. But today, if you'd like to accept Jesus into your heart, I want you to pray this prayer with me. You may already be a believer, but you've had, it's been challenging for you to wait. It's been challenging for you to build the perseverance and the patience to be able to make it through these challenging days. I want to pray for you as well. And you may simply be watching to say, let me just see what this chocolate preacher is going to say next. Well, I want to pray for you because if you're tuning in and even watching this, I believe that the Lord has drawn you to this broadcast, to this program for such a time as this, just to hear a word to encourage you and let you know that God's got you. Will you pray this prayer? As a matter of fact, everybody watching, wherever you are, you may want to bow, you may want to close your eyes, but I'd like for everyone listening today to pray this prayer aloud with me. Dear Lord, I ask you now to come into my heart. I thank you, God, for loving me so much that you gave your only son, and your son, Jesus, gave his life that I might have life. Lord Jesus, I ask you now to come into my heart, to change me from the inside out, to be my Savior and Lord. I choose, Lord, from this day forward to follow you, to love you, to serve you, and to wait on you. I declare that I'm yours, Lord. In the name of Jesus, amen and amen. Well, praise the Lord. Thank you for praying that prayer with me. And if you've prayed it for the first time, I'd like you to do one more action. Take an action to go to our website, www.pasadenachurch.com. And on that homepage, there's a little button that says decision card. Will you just take 2 minutes to fill out that decision card online so that we can know that you have made a fresh decision to follow Christ. You can also go to that page if you're renewing your relationship with Christ. And even if you just simply request special prayer, please make sure you go to PasadenaChurch.com and fill out that information. Secondly, I want to invite all of you who are watching Pasadena Church Sunday morning online. You may watch Sunday Night Live, whichever one that you watch. We want to stay connected with you. And we would love for you to text the word hello. Just as someone who watches us, someone who follows us, and you'd like to be aware of anything that we do in future broadcasts, if you would text hello to 626-602-1165, you'll receive another text back just saying, we've got your information and we'll stay connected. Please do that. And if you are part of the Pasadena Church fam, if you're part of PFAM, hallelujah, please take a moment, family, church family, to text the word member. Text the word member to the same number, 626-602-1165. It'll put you in another place where we can stay in contact and keep you in the loop concerning Pasadena Church, concerning our reopening and our strategies for continuing to reach our community. All of those things, you'll be plugged in if you text member to that number. And then when you receive a follow-up text, press that link and fill out that prompt so that we can have your information to stay connected. We also want you to know that you can continue to follow us on Facebook under Pasadena Church. You can find us on YouTube under Pasadena Church Online. And you can see whenever we post anything new, you can find it on those platforms. We also want you to join us in prayer. We have a powerful time of prayer every morning at 6 a.m. Pacific and 9 a.m. Eastern time. And all you have to do is dial in to this number that's on the screen. Dial into that number, 5949 at the end of it, and you'll be logged into our prayer. They pray, and at the end of the prayer, we open up the line for you to give a prayer request so that we can have people online, live, on the phone, praying for you and praying with you. It's just a powerful time in the Lord. I tell people it's better than a bowl of Wheaties. Hallelujah. And if you're saying, well, Pastor, I appreciate Pasadena Church. I'm thankful for this word. I'm thankful for this, the way that you're serving our community and getting this message and this word out to us. And I like to support Pasadena Church. Well, first of all, our primary support comes from our members who are tithers and givers. But if you're a member, we want to just encourage you to continue to give and tithe if you're able to. We know that so many of you have been laid off or furloughed or unemployed. And we just want you to know we're praying with you and believing God's going to bless you with income and resources. But others, you say, well, I'm still able to give. I want to give. I want to be able to support our church. We have a Cash App. Through Pasadena Church. You can find us there. We have a Zelle app. But then you can also go to PasadenaChurch.com to the giving page, and you can fill that information out. You can give. And you can still give the old-fashioned way by mailing in a gift to Pasadena Church, 404 East Washington Boulevard, Pasadena, California, 91104. Well, I don't know about you, but this has been a glorious time in the Lord. Thank you again so much for joining us today, worshiping with us. And we pray that you would continue to be encouraged, continue to stand, and continue to wait on God. As we close today, we're going to go back into our service to a little reprise of that song, Hold On, Change Is Coming, where we get the choir, we get the band, we even get a little audience participation. God bless you. Thank you for being with us.
Sometimes singing some la-las can help somebody out. So say la la.
La la.
La.
Gonna be all right.
Y'all know I can do that all day, but I'm not here.